I would now like to introduce our presenters. Tyler Creech is a spatial ecologist with the Center for Large Landscape Conservation in Bozeman, Montana. He helps his organization and its partners apply scientific tools to landscape-level conservation, with a focus on preserving landscape connectivity for wildlife populations and mitigating impacts of climate change. Meredith McClure is a lead scientist with Conservation Science Partners based in Truckee, California. She works collaboratively to conduct rigorous, innovative analyses that provide decision-relevant information to management and conservation on the ground. Her work frequently focuses on connectivity-related processes and informing climate change adaptation in a variety of systems and landscapes. Welcome, Tyler and Meredith.
Great. Thanks very much, Mary, and thanks to everybody who's on the line right now listening. We're really grateful for this opportunity to present this new prioritization tool we've developed, and we hope some of you are going to find it useful. So I want to start with just a brief outline of where we're going to be going over the next 45 minutes. I'm going to start by briefly introducing the concept of cross-realm management, then discuss our project objectives, give a little bit of background on our pilot region, the Missouri Headwaters Basin, and then talk about developing a conceptual model and sort of the logic behind how we quantify conservation opportunity. Then I'm going to turn things over to Meredith to talk about how the prioritization tool works, give us a live demonstration, and then she'll talk a little bit about some of the best practices for applying the tool and let you know how you could access this, the tool and the documentation for it. So this project is really oriented around the idea of cross-realm management, which is an emerging topic in natural resource management. And the basic idea behind cross-realm management is that we explicitly consider the connections between the terrestrial and aquatic realms. So scientists and managers have known for a really long time that these two realms are highly connected. We know about flows of water, sediments, nutrients between the realms. We know organisms rely on both of these realms over daily and seasonal timescales and even for different portions of their life. We know that riparian zones are especially critical for ecosystem function and biodiversity. And there are many threats to ecological integrity that are shared or are propagated between these two realms. So there's real benefits to a cross-realm management approach. One benefit is we can overcome what seems sometimes to be an artificial division in research and management between the aquatic and terrestrial. We can also manage simultaneously for targets in connected systems. And ultimately, cross-realm management could allow us to increase the efficiency of our management by taking advantage of what we call co-benefits, so actions that we take in one realm that have benefits for another realm. We had two different objectives with this project. The immediate objective was to develop a tool for stakeholders to allow them to prioritize conservation actions that support ecological integrity. And by ecological integrity, I just mean the ability of an ecosystem to support and maintain ecological processes in a diverse community of organisms. A broader goal of the project, however, was to pilot a quantitative and repeatable approach for incorporating cross-realm thinking into our conservation and management. And there's a number of reasons why we think that a spatial prioritization tool is really a good way to approach cross-realm management. It sort of forces us to locate and incorporate the best available spatial data for our region of interest, and it forces us to make some of these cross-realm connections explicit in our thinking. And ultimately, it can provide an objective and transparent basis for making decisions and supplement our local knowledge and put that local knowledge into a broader landscape context. And sometimes the results of a prioritization tool can even challenge some of our assumptions and our intuitions about the places that we work in. So the geographic area that we selected for our pilot project is the Missouri Headwaters Basin, and that includes about 36,000 square kilometers, mostly in southwest Montana, but also with a little bit of northwest Wyoming included in Yellowstone National Park. And the reason that we chose this site, beyond the fact that it's kind of our backyard, is that this area is just the focus of an incredible amount of conservation attention and activity right now. So there are a bunch of larger NGOs such as Nature Conservancy, Trout Unlimited, and Wildlife Conservation Society that have projects in this region. There are a number of local land trusts and watershed groups that are active, as well as state and federal agencies like the Forest Service and BLM. And in addition, this region actually has relevance at the national scale for conservation as well. GNLCC has identified the basin as part of one of its focal areas for connectivity. And so the high divide area of which the Missouri Headwaters Basin is a part is really critical for connecting some of the last remaining large ecosystems, large intact ecosystems in the region, such as the Greater Yellowstone ecosystems and the crown of the continent. And also the Missouri Headwaters Basin is one of two demonstration sites in the nation for what's called the National Drought Resiliency Partnership. So it's really a great place to design and test a tool like this. I wanted to give you just a little bit more detail on land management in the basin. So the map here shows in white are the privately owned lands, which tend to be concentrated low elevations in the major river valleys. But a lot of the basin, about 40% of it, is publicly owned lands, which is mostly high elevation forest. So the green and brown in the map are land administered by U.S. Forest Service and the Bureau of Land Management. And the population density in the basin is low overall, but parts of it are growing very rapidly. So the Gallatin Valley in the northeast portion of the basin has very fast population growth. So the first step in this project was constructing a conceptual model of this ecosystem. And our goal specifically was to identify the major conservation targets, the threats to and stresses on those targets, and actions we could take to address those threats and stresses. And we were very lucky to have the participation of a wide range of stakeholders, primarily during a workshop we held in Bozeman last spring. And we had representatives from NGOs, from state and federal agencies, and from academia to help us construct our model. And the conceptual model can really be broken down into four major components shown here. If we start on the right side of the diagram, targets are the things we want to conserve or restore. So these are the major components of ecological integrity in the basin that we're interested in. Targets are affected by stresses, which are basically anything that is negatively impacting the target. The threats are the things that are causing those stresses, and actions are the things we can do about it. We call this linkage from actions through threats and stresses to targets a results chain. And to make that concept a little bit less abstract, I have a simple example for you here. So suppose one of our ecological targets is habitat connectivity. So we want to preserve the ability for wildlife to move through the landscape between habitat patches. One of the stresses that might be negatively impacting habitat connectivity is landscape fragmentation, so the division of these large contiguous patches into smaller separate patches. What's causing that stress might be land use change, so conversion of large ranches into subdivisions. And one thing we could do about that is negotiate conservation easements with private landowners. So that's the basic conceptual modeling logic we applied. And after a very intense day of conceptual modeling with our panel of experts, we came up with this very complex model shown here, which if you're the person responsible for translating that into a quantitative prioritization tool, that's fairly terrifying. So what we really needed to do was find a way to simplify this model and just pick out the key parts. And we came up with three criteria to help us do that. The first criterion was, are there good spatial data available to represent that component? So do we have data of the appropriate extent and resolution and quality that we feel comfortable including it in the model? Second criterion was, what's the degree of support for a portion of the model from the scientific literature? So some of these connections between components in the model are relatively weak or indirect, and some are much stronger, and we used a survey of the literature to try to pick out those connections with the most support. And the third criterion was just the level of stakeholder interest. So the people that we think are going to use this tool might be more or less interested in particular ecological targets and actions to improve them. So we applied those criteria, and after going through this whole simplification process, we ended up with the conceptual model shown here, where the actions are on the left side of the diagram in the square boxes, and the targets are on the right side of the diagram in the ovals. We've taken out sort of the middle of the diagram, the threats and stresses, for the sake of clarity here, so you can see exactly which actions are connected to which targets. And one thing you'll notice right away is that a lot of these connections are cross-realm connections, so instances in which an action that takes place in one realm has an influence on an ecological target in another realm. So I want to spend just a little bit of time mentioning those five ecological targets that we settled on, which were upland vegetation composition and structure, within habitat connectivity, riparian potential, normative flow regime, and stream health. And in some cases, these are intentionally pretty broad targets that are meant to capture major aspects of ecological integrity. And one key point here is that for every one of these targets, we needed a way of quantifying it. So we needed one or more proxy variables with spatial data available to estimate the condition of that target across the basin. And I've listed some of these proxy variables in the rightmost column of the table. There's obviously a lot to discuss here, and I'm going to have to refer you to our user guide document for much more detailed explanations of why we think these targets are important and how we represented them in our model. And similarly, I just want to touch briefly on the 9 conservation or restoration actions we included, and those are land protection, road decommissioning, bridge and culvert upgrades, forest fuels management, irrigation adjustment, grazing management, stream and riparian restoration, woody encroachment control, and soil health management. And note again that these tend to be rather broad classes of actions in some cases that reflect that there are multiple ways to achieve a particular conservation goal. So for instance, if we want to protect ecologically valuable lands, we might do that through either conservation easements or outright fee purchases of land. And similarly, if we are interested in forest fuels management, we could do that through prescribed fire. We could also do that through thinning. And again, a lot more information on the actions we picked here and why can be found in the user guide that we'll refer you to at the end of this presentation. So I'm going to wrap up this first half of the talk by discussing sort of the basic logic behind our prioritization process, which is really based on this idea of conservation or restoration opportunity value. And by that, I just mean the relative importance of a spatial unit within the landscape for restoring or maintaining ecological integrity in the basin. And the first question that needs to be answered then is, what is that spatial unit? And most existing prioritization algorithms actually use gridded surfaces as the inputs. So the spatial unit would be a square pixel. But we actually felt that for our project, using hydrologic units was a more appropriate choice because a lot of our ecological targets are aquatic targets. So we ended up using what are called HUC 12 level units, also known as subwatersheds. And in the map here, Those HUC 12 units are the small irregular polygons outlined in light gray. So there are about 413 of those within the basin, and they average about 90 square kilometers in area. And there are also some real benefits of using hydrologic units as the spatial unit, specifically for integrating those units into the prioritization algorithm. And Meredith will discuss some of those benefits in more detail later on in the talk. And the logic behind our prioritization approach is actually really simple. We assume that the opportunity for conservation or restoration within each subwatershed depends on two factors. The first is action availability. And by that, I just mean, are there relatively few or many locations within a subwatershed where we could implement the action? The second factor is target condition. So in other words, what do we know about the ecological condition of that particular target within the subwatershed that helps us decide whether conservation or restoration is warranted there or not? And thinking a little more about that first factor, action availability, the area in which we could reasonably implement an action really varies across the landscape for a particular action, and it also varies among actions. For instance, if our action of interest was land protection through conservation easements, that's an action that really only makes sense to pursue on privately owned lands that aren't already managed for conservation. So what we end up with is a sort of an action footprint that looks like the map on the left there, where the white areas are these privately owned lands where we would consider pursuing that action, and the black sections are public lands and other areas we wouldn't consider for that action. And similarly, on the right map shows the action footprint for a different action, adjusting irrigation practices. That's something we would only reasonably pursue on lands that are currently irrigated. So we end up with a figure like this where some of these heavily irrigated valleys show up as possibilities for action, right? Whereas most of the basin does not. And the second factor, the target condition, is quite a bit more complex, and we utilized a wide variety of spatial data sets to estimate condition of our ecological targets across the basin. And I've thrown in just a few examples here of some of those data sets. So for instance, we've used information on the degree of human modification in the landscape, some model data on stream biotic condition, maps of valley bottom areas, and model data on shift in the timing of stream flow. All of these data sets and our justifications for using them are well documented in the user guide, and we can talk about them at the end of the talk if we have time. And one last important distinction I need to make is between two different types of actions. So we have conservation actions that we would typically pursue in areas that are relatively pristine, where we want to preserve the current conditions. And the flip side is that we have restoration actions that we would typically pursue in locations where our ecological targets have been degraded, and our goal would be to improve those conditions. So the logic for assigning priorities is essentially flipped. For conservation actions, we want to assign higher priority to those subwatersheds where the target of interest is in better condition and thus more likely to merit protection. For restoration, we want to assign the higher priority to those subwatersheds where the target of interest is actually in poorer condition and thus more likely to benefit from restoration actions. And almost all of the actions that we included in our model and our prioritization tool happen to be restoration actions. The big exception is land protection, which we usually pursue to protect places that are already in the best possible shape. And I've had to really gloss over a lot of the details so far for the sake of time, but I want to just once again mention that if you'd like any more information on the links in the conceptual model, any of the spatial data sets we used, or how we calculated this opportunity value, We have about a 60-page user guide that provides all that information, and Meredith will tell you how to access that at the end of the presentation. And I'm going to turn things over now to Meredith to give us a demo of the prioritization tool. So just hang with us for a second as Mary helps us switch the presenter so you can see Meredith's screen.
Thanks, Tyler. Let's see. I believe I've got it handed over. Mary, Tyler, do you see my screen?
Yes, we do.
Okay, great. Okay, so we're going to shift gears a bit from covering the concepts and the data that have gone into the tool to taking a quick look at the tool itself. I'll talk a little bit about how it works. I'll do a quick demo and show some example results, and then we'll wrap up with some guidance for accessing and using the tool. So the prioritization tool is based on an existing conservation prioritization algorithm called zonation, which is fairly complex. There's also existing software to implement zonation, but that's also really complex to understand and use. The user manual is 290 pages. So zonation is a really powerful and useful tool, but this is a totally unreasonable learning curve and time investment for most people we know of who are thinking about where best to implement these cross-realm actions in the Missouri Headwaters Basin. So our goal was to make use of this existing resource, but to do the vast majority of the legwork in applying it by creating a really user-friendly wrapper for zonation that's tailored to the Missouri Headwaters Basin. So it has options, settings, and data inputs all ready to go based on the conceptual model that Tyler talked about. And it requires very little technical knowledge on the part of users. Okay, I do want to talk a little bit about what goes into zonation and what it's doing behind the scenes so that this doesn't feel like a black box. So I'll describe this a bit in very non-math terms. The goal is to rank planning units by their relative value for conserving or restoring multiple targets. Zonation does that by iteratively removing individual units from the landscape. So each time it's assessing which unit would cause minimal loss of value across all targets of interest left in the landscape. There's several options for how that's assessed mathematically to meet different conservation needs, but in each sort of flavor of that algorithm, two core ideas are considered. So the algorithm is maintaining complementarity so that the remaining units in the landscape collectively retain representation of all the conservation targets of interest. And then also maintaining connectivity so that priority units tend to be clustered rather than fragmented. And that particular feature and the options for it are really useful for our purposes. So in one version of the algorithm, the aim is just to maintain clusters of units so that large intact areas can be protected. But here we use a different setting that emphasizes up and downstream relationships among hydrologic units. So that lets us account for potential downstream benefits of conservation actions when we're prioritizing units, which is really helpful for our freshwater targets. For example, if we conserve private land along a river's main stem, that may have high local value, but in a different example, reducing grazing pressure along a headwater stream could yield some downstream benefits too. So we wanted to be able to factor that in. So Tyler mentioned that our units of analysis are these HUC-12 sub-watersheds, and we did that for a few key reasons. First, those units have defined upstream and downstream relationships, which is necessary for zonation to be able to consider those potential downstream benefits. And in our particular application of the zonation algorithm, we have this complication that actions and targets don't always have the same footprint. We may be interested in a land-based action, such as grazing management, in order to benefit a water-based target, such as stream health. So we needed to be able to aggregate our over some units that contain both land and water. In order to quantify conservation opportunity for those sorts of linkages. There are some further details, a lot of further details about the underpinnings of the tool and the algorithm in the full documentation that Tyler referenced. And again, I'll point you to that at the end of the webinar. But for now, I'd like to actually just show you the tool. I'll start with a couple of pointers for running it. It's really easy to access. It's downloadable freely online through a link that we'll provide at the end here. It does, unfortunately, only run on Windows operating systems at this time. The zonation software it's built around is Windows only. And the other key requirement is the R and R Studio software, which is free. If you're not familiar with R, it's a statistical programming environment, but you do not need to be at all familiar with R or statistics or coding or anything more technical than following a few download and setup instructions. It's just the platform that the tool is built on. Okay, so let's take a look at the tool itself. I'm going to switch screens here. Mary and Tyler, can you confirm that you can see the tool at this point?
Yep, fine.
Okay, great. Okay, so this is our tool interface. You'll see some options for run settings along the left side. You'll see a map interface so that you can explore the data layers that are being considered. And then buttons for actually running the tool are here along the bottom. So I'm going to start with pointing to this list of actions of interest. These are the actions that Tyler briefly discussed at the beginning of the webinar. So to run the tool, you start by selecting your action of interest. And when you do that, you'll see the map interface change as well as the list of targets. So if I choose private land protection, I'm going to take a second here because I'm running it on a remote server. I apologize for that. I'll be quicker on a local machine. But you'll see the map update so that you see the conservation opportunity maps for the targets associated with the action you chose. Again, this is all driven by the conceptual model, so you will only see the targets that are associated with the action you chose. For example, with managing soil health, we just have two associated targets. You can explore the map layers once those load. So this is showing relative conservation opportunity for stream health. And I can change that to look at opportunity to maintain normative flow regime. And the action footprints that Tyler introduced can also be overlaid so that you can see where those actions are available to implement. You can also change the background view if a satellite view is a bit more helpful for orienting yourself. And you can zoom in and out of the map to focus in on particular units of interest. So there's the ability to explore these spatial data layers without using any form of GIS. Once you've selected an action of interest, you'll want to set your target weights. So this tells the algorithm which targets are most important to you, and these should be ranked based on your own personal interests and the goals that you have for your particular action. These are sliders. Sometimes it's helpful to set these so that they add to one just for interpretation, but it's not necessary. And any targets that you're not interested in considering can just be set to zero and they won't be included. Finally, there's this section for whether you'd like to consider downstream benefits for stream-based targets. And we have a few options here. These are more fully described in the documentation, but they're relative weights of those benefits for how much a particular action might have benefits to targets downstream. You'll want to give your run a name. It'll save some output files to the directory that the tool is in once you download it. So type in a name here. And then it's as simple as hitting save run and run prioritization. So you'll see this scary terminal window come up. It's running zonation in the background. You don't need to interact with this at all, but it's a nice way to know when the run is finished. So this will run as long as there are units left in the landscape. When it's finished, it'll close on its own. And by choosing this check run status, once the run is complete, it'll load the results on the map so that it can be explored. So that's the tool. That's all the technical expertise necessary to work with it. There is a tab here for some more information. We have just a brief overview of the tool and the project, as well as links to resources, the full documentation, as well as a quick start guide that just has instructions for getting the tool up and running. And that's about it. So I'm going to go back over to slides so that we can do this a bit like a cooking show and look at the results. So as a first example, this is a run that considered a single target. I want to show you some simple results first, just so we can get oriented a bit. So the map on the left is conservation opportunity for land protection to maintain shrub connectivity. And then on the right is the prioritization result when we don't consider any other targets. So as you can see, the units with high opportunity for conserving shrub connectivity get high ranks in the output. The scaling of that output is a little bit different just because it's converting to a rank, but you can see that the high opportunity units have high priority. Can kind of see the same pattern and the same result for stream health. Here I only considered stream health, and we see high opportunity units get high priority. And then when we consider both targets, in this case assigning a little bit higher weight to stream health, you can see that the result is basically a blend of the previous maps, where we're emphasizing units where there's opportunity for land protection to benefit both targets. This gets a little more complicated the more targets you consider, so we really recommend going this route of exploring the individual maps, gradually building up so that it's a little bit less of a black box what you're getting out. Lastly, I can overlay the action footprint so that once I've identified those priority units, I can see where within those units the action of interest is available to implement. Okay, I also wanted to demonstrate what happens when we consider those downstream benefits of actions that pertain to stream targets. So in this case, I've run a prioritization of stream and riparian restoration as the action, with equal weight given to stream health and normative flow regime as targets. And here on the left is the result with no weight given to downstream benefits. In the middle is considering minimal downstream benefits. And then on the right is considering large downstream benefits. So you can see a couple areas where the result differs. So in the far southeast portion of the landscape, we see increasing benefits or increasing priority assigned to those units as we begin to consider downstream benefits. And in looking at this map up at the top, we can see that there are a lot of headwater streams there. And importantly, a lot of those headwater streams feed into stretches that are in relatively high priority units. So what we see is a shift toward prioritizing units that have a lot of headwater streams that have potential to benefit downstream hooks that also have high conservation opportunity. And this gets a little confusing to wrap your head around, but again, this is further spelled out in detail in the documentation. In contrast, sort of up here in the northern portion of the basin, you can see some decline in priority values. So we see some bright purples there on the left, fading down to some more lavender shades on the right. And those are kind of along this more major river where there's less opportunity for downstream benefits within those hooks. Okay, so I want to conclude with just a few guidelines on some best practices for use. First, again, we keep referring to the documentation. This has been a really brief introduction to the tool, but there's a lot of information about how the conceptual model was developed, the data sources that were used to map conservation opportunity, and then how these various run settings impact your results. Those are all critical to understand in order to apply the results in a meaningful way. Again, as Tyler discussed, in many cases we were lacking spatial data for specific targets, and in many cases used proxy data sets. So it's very important to understand whether those represent your target in a way that's appropriate for your use. It's also really important to understand what the tool is doing. Again, especially once your runs get fairly complicated with many targets considered and different weights, the results get to be a little bit black boxy. It's difficult to trace back to the individual target layers. So we would really strongly recommend sort of building up these runs, doing simple runs that build into the run that you're ultimately interested in so that you can see the change and the effect of the choices that you're making. And it's important to understand how the different weights assigned to targets and the different downstream benefit settings can affect the results. And finally, we just urge users to apply these results responsibly. We recommend running several alternative prioritizations, but again, that's for the purpose of understanding what the tool is doing, not for achieving a result that fits your preconceived idea of what it should look like. Again, it's really critical to understand the data sources that are driving that result before you apply it. And we really strongly recommend using this tool in conjunction with other information, particularly local information, because so much of what we've needed to use in this tool is at a fairly coarse level. So finally, to access the tool and the documentation, this is available through the Center for Large Landscape Conservation website on the library page. If you go there under the Advanced Science section, you'll see the citation for the tool and the documentation, as well as a download link. So that will take you to a Google Drive folder where you can download the tool itself, as well as all of the documentation. So with that, I'd like to thank NIFWF in particular for funding this work. This would not have been possible without the existence of the zonation algorithm and software developed by the University of Helsinki. So we're very grateful for being able to use those existing tools. We're extremely grateful for all of the participants in the stakeholder workshop we held to determine the conceptual model at the very beginning of this project. And we got lots of great feedback and input from colleagues at CLLC as well as here at Conservation Science Partners that very much improved this work. If you need to contact us, our email addresses are here at the bottom, and we're happy to answer any questions now or those that you think of later.
Great, Meredith and Tyler, this is Mary speaking. So we're open for questions. Those guys are open for questions. As I said, you can either type in your question into the question pane, which should be on the right side of your screen, or you can raise your hand and I can unmute you and you can ask that question via phone or computer mic. We do have a couple of questions in the queue, so I'll start with them. The first question is asked by David. Are map layers publicly available?
Yes, they are. First off, they're all included when you download the tool itself. So you'll have ready access to them within the tool package. And Tyler, can you remind me if we have them available to download elsewhere?
Yeah, so when Meredith says the map layers are available, that means the conservation or restoration opportunity layers. So that data is at the HUC 12 level. If you're looking for the actual raw data that went into these, so if you wanted, for instance, to go back and get projections for stream flow for individual streams, that data is not currently packaged with the tool. But we have basically we only relied on publicly available data sets, and in the documentation I have a description of each of those data sets and a citation for where you can find it. And these are all things that were easy to get our hands on. So they're all of the data that went into the tool is something that others could easily get a hold of.
Thank you. So question from Renee. Are there examples of how this tool has been used on the ground?
No, not yet. It's brand new. We very much hope there will be.
And you're looking for feedback, right?
Absolutely.
Absolutely, yeah. So we just finished this project about a week or two ago, and we're really excited about working with anybody out there who is interested in using this tool, who would like to learn more, even if you're working in a different geographic area and they're just interested about how this approach might be applied to your own region of interest. So please do reach out to me and Meredith if you have any interest.
The next question is from Jonathan. Why is conservation only considered for private lands when things like your examples of ongoing grazing in public headwaters may need to be addressed by management restrictions?
Do you want me to
Tyler,
take that one?
Tyler, do you want one? To take that, or I can?
Sure.
Go for it, and I'll add on.
So for if you're talking specifically about conservation by land protection, which is the sort of the flavor of conservation that we've included in this model, we feel that the way that that's achieved by the stakeholders that are most likely to use this is through conservation easements or land purchases, and that's something that we can do on private lands. I totally understand the point that there are lots of actions on public lands. You mentioned grazing, I think. And if you look at the grazing management action, that one does not just apply to private lands. In fact, that's all on public lands. So Forest Service and BLM grazing allotments, which is what we had data for. I'm not sure if I've completely answered the question, but I hope that at least helps somewhat.
Yeah, I was going to say the same, just to emphasize that each of these actions has a different footprint. They're not all considered strictly on private land. I believe land protection is the only one that's restricted to private land that's currently unprotected. Most of the others apply in whole or in part to management of public lands.
Thank you. Looks like somebody has their hand raised. David, I'm going to unmute you if you have a question. Sometimes people accidentally hit the hand button. So he doesn't appear to have a question. So we have a little bit more time for questions. So be sure to either raise your hand and I can unmute you, or you can type it in. We'll give it another minute.
Hi, Mary. I have a question.
Okay. Sean?
Hi, this is Sean Finn. Thanks very much, Tyler and Meredith. Great presentation and great example of the use of zonation and the software for conservation planning. I noticed early on in the presentation when you started showing some of the input data that I wasn't seeing sort of this stark contrast at the park boundary, particularly things like human modification. And I was encouraged when I saw that your study area included the park, because you might expect some different opportunities and threats and things in the park as opposed to immediately outside the park. But then as you went along, I also saw that there wasn't a whole lot of differentiation in terms of what some of the conservation actions could be. And there are certainly policy and legal restrictions or differences, let's say, between what's possible inside the park and what's outside the park. And so I guess my question is was land ownership one of the important input data layers? And if not, can you speak a little bit to sort of the cultural and legal aspects of what kinds of conservation actions are possible on different, you know, in different Hub 12s, for example?
That's a great question, Sean. I think my answer would be that this tool is designed primarily to look at ecological value on the landscape. And we are in no way trying to minimize the importance of all sorts of other constraints on conservation, land ownership, is one of those important ones. But I think our objective with the tool is to sort of fill in ecological side of the equation and give users a sense of where would be the best places to implement these actions in the absence of these other constraints. And then they can take that information and use other types of knowledge. So knowledge about, land administration, about social factors, and use that sort of as an overlay on the outputs of this tool to decide where are the places that the tool predicts are ecologically, make sense ecologically to pursue an action, and the other factors that we didn't consider support that action or make it possible.
Yeah, to add to that, many of the actions we considered, for example, woody encroachment control, we consider those to be available regardless of land ownership. But of course, the way that those are implemented and restrictions on those implementations vary by ownership and by the agency managing public lands. We didn't get into that level of detail with this tool. Again, it's meant to be a fairly coarse kind of first pass at identifying these priority areas from an ecological perspective. But those are certainly important considerations. We didn't want to get into the realm of really thinking about the level at which these actions could be implemented or specific strategies for them, but to consider them as sort of broad blanket groups of actions that that may be possible across the landscape.
Hey, thank you.
I just sent everybody the link to the CLCC library via the chat box. So if you guys want to copy that or open it, you want to bookmark it. We have one more question, and it's from Lee. Did the scale or grain of all of the input data layers match, or did you have to resample some of the data? What scale did you use?
Another great question. And the answer to the first part is no, of course, they never match, even though that would be great. So I think Meredith may be able to help me remember, but I think the finest resolution was 30 meters for some of these land cover type data sets. And the coarsest resolution was, I believe, either 90 or 270 meters for some of this human modification data. And what we ended up doing was, yeah, we had to sort of reconcile those. So the condition values were calculated at a very fine resolution. So we downsampled things to try to capture as much variation as possible. But then when we calculated a final opportunity value for a specific huck, we fed much coarser resolution data into the algorithm because it's the same value for all pixels within any particular sub-watershed. I know that's probably confusing without a greater understanding of the guts of the model, but yeah, the short answer is there are different resolutions. We matched them as best we could.
Yeah, they were all relatively high spatial resolution. So valley bottom extent data at 10 meter resolution. And then I believe the human modification layer Tyler referenced was 90 meter resolution. Maybe the more important consideration is some of the modeled proxy data, for example, changes in stream temperature or stream biotic condition. Those are interpolated. And so there's a more of a thematic resolution that may be more critical for determining the preciseness, the precision of those estimates within a given huck. In terms of the spatial resolution, right, we worked with the finest resolution data we could, as long as we could, up until the point of calculating a condition metric for the huck level. And so at that point, the spatial resolution really becomes less important, but we retained the spatial resolution as long as we could during that calculation, if that makes sense. We're happy to follow up on that.
Thank you. Next question, this could be the last one, unless some pop in. It's from Kim. Are you planning to run the prioritization in any other areas?
Yeah, so this is a pilot tool, and we would love to see it extended to other areas or to be involved in that. I think there's huge potential to do that. Again, it depends on each landscape. I think each has to be customized depending on the key targets and actions available in a given landscape, and that requires some stakeholder input. There are also differences in data availability across landscapes, but you know, I think having worked through this process, we have a way forward for thinking about how to do that in different landscapes where the actual guts of the tool may vary a bit. But we think that's absolutely possible and of value, and would love to see that happen.
Yeah, I would just add that Meredith is absolutely correct that the hard part of this project was sort of the conceptual process of designing an approach for prioritizing. Applying this to a different geographic area would require new consideration of actions and targets, and sort of grabbing the spatial data for the appropriate new geographic area. But I think a lot of the conceptual work has already been figured out, which would make that process go a lot faster.
Great. That was a good question, I think, to end on. And there are no more questions in the queue, so let's go ahead and wrap up. First of all, I'd like to thank Tyler and Meredith for presenting today, and also like to thank you guys, our audience, for attending the webinar. Meredith and Tyler, do you have any closing words or any last-minute things that you'd like to include?
No, just to
reiterate. Go ahead, Tyler.
Nope, I was just going to say thanks for everyone's interest.
Yeah, thank you all for attending. And again, we're very open to feedback of any kind as you test out the tool or based on what you saw today. We'd be happy to hear it and happy to answer any further questions as they come up.
Great. For those of you in the audience that came in late, I will send an email to everybody with a link to the webinar recording as well as the slides. And I'll also include how you can find access that the tool if you haven't copied the link from the chat. Pod over on the right-hand side. So with that said, goodbye, everyone, and enjoy your day.